Brothers and sisters, the Lord be with you.
And with
a reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. Luke. It was a scholar of the law who stood up to test Jesus and said, "Teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus said to him, "What is written in the law? How do you read it?" He said in reply, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your being, and with all your strength, and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself." He replied to him, "You have answered correctly. Do this and you will live." But because he wished to justify himself, he said to Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" Jesus replied, "A man fell victim to robbers as he went down from Jerusalem to Jericho. They stripped him and beat him and went off, leaving him half dead. A priest happened to be going down that road, but when he saw him, he passed by on the opposite side. Likewise, a Levite came to the place, and when he saw him, he passed by on the opposite side. But a Samaritan traveler who came upon him was moved with compassion at the sight. He approached the victim, poured oil and wine over his wounds and bandaged them. Then he lifted him on his own animal and took him to an inn and cared for him. The next day he took out 2 silver coins and gave them to the innkeeper with the instructions, 'Take care of him. If you spend more than what I have given you, I shall repay you on my way back.' Which of these three, in your opinion, was neighbor to the robber's victim?" He answered, "The one who treated him with mercy." Jesus said to him, "Go and do likewise." The Gospel of the Lord. The command which I enjoin on you today is not too mysterious and remote for you. It is not up in the sky that you shall say, "Who will go up in the sky and get it for us and tell us that we may carry it out?" Nor is it across the sea that you should say, "Who will cross the sea and get it for us that we may carry it out?" No, it is something very near to you, already in your mouths and in your hearts. You have only to carry it out. Everyone who complains about the church usually complains about the rules. "Oh, the church has too many rules. The church is all about keeping rules." But when you take a look at it, God has made salvation very simple. That's the point Moses is trying to make to the Israelites in the first reading. "The command which I enjoin on you today is not too mysterious and remote for you." Moses is saying here, there's no riddle in what God has asked of us. We don't need to travel to the ends of the earth to find out what God wants from us. He's told us what he wants. He's given us the answer, and it's simple. So what is it? What does God expect from us? Jesus answers that in our gospel today. A scholar asks Jesus what he needs to inherit eternal life. And Jesus asks him, what does it say in the law? And the scholar replies by quoting the Shema, the heart of the Mosaic law found in the book of Deuteronomy. "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your being, with all your strength and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself." That is the core of the law of Moses. That is the sum and foundation of the law. The Decalogue, or the Ten Commandments as we call them, are simply an expansion, a fleshing out of the Shema. And the rest of the book of Deuteronomy is a fleshing out of the Decalogue. So how do I love God with all my heart, being, strength, and mind? Well, you start by not worshiping other gods. Don't abuse God's name and keep holy the Sabbath day. In other words, give God worship and honor. How do I love my neighbor as myself? Well, you start by honoring your parents. You don't kill your neighbor or steal his spouse or his stuff. You don't lie to or about him and don't envy what he has. So loving God and neighbor begins by fighting any unholy desires that we may have. Unless we do that first, we can't grow in love. And the only way we can put away unholy desires is through prayer and fasting. The scholar then asked Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" Now, a couple of interesting things to note here. First, the verse says, "But because he wished to justify himself." Now, that begs two questions. Justify himself to whom? Or justify himself from what? The second thing to note is, the gospel doesn't answer that question. This guy obviously has a grudge against somebody. There's somebody he hates. Is it a relative? Is it a fellow scholar? Is it something political? Does he hate the Romans? We don't know. But it's significant to understand that the gospel doesn't answer his question because of what Jesus says next. Jesus then breaks into his famous Good Samaritan parable. Now, why a Samaritan? Of all the people that Jesus could have chosen to make the hero of this story, why a Samaritan? Because as much as the Jews of Jesus' day bickered and fought with each other over almost everything, one thing they could all agree on is that they all hated the Samaritans. The Jews hated the Samaritans more than they hated pagans, because Samaritans were apostates. They were former Jews that had left the Jewish religion and mixed elements of Judaism with elements of paganism. And for that, for turning their backs on the covenant and on the temple, the Jews never forgave them. So Jesus, in making a Samaritan the hero of the story, while at the same time making the priest and the Levite pinnacles of Jewish society, an embarrassment, and their failure to show mercy to the victim of the robbers, would have infuriated every Jew who was listening to this parable. But as a result of this parable, Jesus couldn't make his meaning more clear. Everyone is your neighbor. Therefore, you don't have an excuse to hate anybody. You don't have cause to hold a grudge against anyone. And that's why we don't know why this scholar wished to justify himself. It's irrelevant. For that detail to be included, it would have been a distraction, because there's no justification to hold anybody in disdain. Now, aren't we all like this scholar on some level? Don't we all hold contempt against someone and we attempt to rationalize it? He's voting for Trump? Can't be friends with him anymore. She's voting for Hillary? Must be some kind of wingnut. Muslims? Don't want to get too close to them. They're all religious fanatical terrorists. So many people went into a tailspin when they learned of the Muslim mosque that's being built right next door to us on Central Avenue. Relax. Folks, please, relax. I was in Woonsocket, stationed for 5 years at St. Agatha and Precious Blood. We had a mosque 3 miles away from us in North Smithfield. Nothing ever happened. Very peaceful neighborhood. Think of all of the reasons we use to hold people in disdain. Black, white, civilian, police, Muslim, Jew, Christian, atheist. Think of all of the ways we use to build walls between us and our neighbor. None of it is justified in the eyes of God. And that's why we have all the rules that we have in the church. If you take the time to closely examine the rules, you see that they're all geared toward training us to love God and love our neighbor. Going to church on Sunday, keep holy the Sabbath day, because you can't love God unless you're also willing to honor, worship, and obey Him. Not just every now and then, but always. Think about your own marriages. What if you decided that you were only going to love and honor your spouse on Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, and every other Sunday, and not the other days of the week? Now, do you expect that this marriage is going to be in for a rocky road? Probably. So why do we treat God any differently? God deserves to be honored, worshiped, and loved all the time, not just 2 Sundays a month. Abortion, thou shalt not kill. Because you can't love your neighbor if you're willing to kill your neighbor or consent to somebody else killing your neighbor. Don't eat meat on Fridays during Lent. Loving God. Oh, come on, Father. Do you really mean that God cares what I eat on Friday? No, He doesn't. But a small sacrifice on the day we remember His great sacrifice is an expression of appreciation. And appreciation is the doorway to loving. Marriage between one man and one woman. Loving God and our neighbor. Because a marriage to serve God and society, it has to be open to at least the possibility of procreation. That extends to the transgender controversy. Why does the church oppose somebody wanting to change their gender? Because first of all, that states that God made a mistake. I was born a man, but deep inside I'm really a woman. God made a mistake. No, God doesn't mess up. And to insinuate that he did mess up shows a lack of appreciation for the gift he has made you. You are a gift from God, just the way you are. And you have a place in God's plan in the gender that you were born with. Secondly, it is not the responsibility of society to cater to the particulars of the individual. Okay, I, Father Cisco, now self-identify with a senior citizen. I feel that because of the wisdom I've acquired after 20 years of ministry and all the aches, pains, and medical issues that I have, I self-identify with a 70-year-old. So I'm a 50-year-old man trapped in a 70-year-old body. So I want to retire right now and collect my full pension right now and my full Social Security benefits and get senior citizen discounts wherever I go right now. Follow this mentality to its logical end. It's chaos. It is not the responsibility of society to cater to the particulars of the individual. Rather, it's the responsibility of the individuals to work for the bettering of society. That's how Christianity works. Which brings us to charity. On the parish surveys, which we're still working on, by the way, one comment that's come up several times is that I'm always asking for money. True! Guilty as charged. I don't deny that. But what do I ask money for? Not to make my life more comfortable, but to take care of the poor and the needy, or support the organizations that are taking care of the poor and the needy, which was Christ's mandate to us, loving our neighbor. I was hungry and you gave me food, etc., etc., etc. And the second thing I ask money for is to maintain these two churches, which you made very clear to me from the moment I walked through the door that you didn't want to close. And yes, I did use Leo money. I used money from Leo savings to help Cecilia when they repaired the stairs in front of the church a few years ago. And yes, I did take money from the sale of St. Cecilia's convent and rectory to pay a portion of the debt that was incurred by St. Leo. Because that's what Christians do. We help each other. Because we love each other. All of the rules of the church are designed to help us fully love God and fully love our neighbor. Because loving God and loving neighbor is our salvation. And blessed be God forever. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.